at 50th Street and 31st Avenue, in the heart of South Central Minneapolis, there is a bridge. True enough, the principal architectural feature at that intersection is a place of worship, where a large group of believers gather to glorify Jesus Christ. But a bridge exists there as well. The place of worship is, of course, Lake Nokomis Lutheran Church. And the bridge, it is the collective force and spirit of this church's congregation. A bridge created and sustained by the Holy Spirit of God, whereby Jesus Christ comes to people. In the sanctuary where this congregation worships is a beautiful baptismal font. The font is a part of the bridge. It is a place where, by means of the Holy Sacrament, hundreds of children have been brought to Jesus Christ, and in so doing have helped to strengthen and sustain the bridge. Our past has been blessed. Our present shows countless signs of health and growth under the blessings of the Lord of the Church. Our future is bright with His promises. What stands before us, only He knows. But surely the future will see us, led by the Holy Spirit, each living to proclaim proudly the idea that I am a bridge, living as His bridge to the lives of His people.
The church was first founded in 1907. At that time, this neighborhood was mostly, as I understand it, potato fields, very little property up. Most of the houses, if you look in the neighborhood, were built in the 20s or later. The church actually started out as a Sunday school. A man named Joachim Anfinson lived on 50th and Woodlawn, and he actually went to Bethlehem Lutheran, which is now at 41st and Lindale, but was even farther away then. And he was concerned that the kids in the neighborhood didn't have anywhere that they could go to Sunday school. So he actually started a Sunday school in his house. And a couple of students from what is now Luther Seminary actually came on Sundays and helped him. One of them, Omar Brenny, actually ended up becoming a pastor of the church in the 1930s. Then, after that, Bethlehem Lutheran provided them funds to buy a property at 29th Avenue and 49th Street, and they put up their first structure, a small chapel there. And they continued to have Sunday school classes there, and some worship services, and they also had a women's auxiliary group that started there. Or Ladies' Aid Society is what they called them at the time. In 1912, the first church, the group actually formed the first church, which was named Bethesda English Lutheran Church. At the time, Lyle Halverson was the mission pastor for the United Norwegian Lutheran Church Mission Board, and he became the first pastor of the church and shared that duty with another church in the neighborhood, Nazareth Lutheran. He actually ended up becoming pastor of Nazareth Lutheran after that. He stayed in that structure until 1920, when the congregation purchased a lot for a new church home at the corner of 31st Avenue and 50th Street, which is where the church sits today. In 1922, the congregation broke ground for the first unit of the new church building, which was actually a sub-auditorium which seated 300 people. So it was actually a below-ground church to start with. In 1923, they changed the name of the church to Lake Nokomis Lutheran Church. After World War II, they had the baby boom, and they had so many members that they were having three services a day, or every Sunday at the church, and they still didn't have enough room. Before they actually built a new church, though, they put up a parish house, which is, as I understand it, what the education wing is here now. That took care of the problems with not enough room for the kids, but it didn't solve the problem with not enough room for church services. And so they, in 1958, they appointed a long-range planning committee to look at what they should do next. And they decided in 1960, the congregation adopted its recommendation to put up a new church structure, which is the one where the church is now. I started here, the narthex, the front of the church, the gathering space, was about 10 feet wide and it was about 8 feet tall. And to think of having all these services there and not having any space, you know, for people to gather. So in 2001, a new renovation took place. Was made much larger, which required the removal of six rows of pews from the sanctuary and the moving of the choir from the loft, which was originally above the smaller narthex, to the front of the church. And as John Burgley said, it required the choir to behave in church because they're now up front. Kermit Norquist was the president of this congregation at the time that it moved from the old church to the new. He was my neighbor, and he actually, at the time, wanted to get out of his house, but there was no place in the neighborhood for older people that wanted to stay in the neighborhood. And so the church helped to get built, Nokomis Square, where we have a lot of members there too, and a lot of people that gave them a chance to move out of their house but still stay in this neighborhood that they like so well and continue to go to this church. In 1978, when we were a young couple, and at the time there weren't a lot of young couples in the neighborhood. We were the youngest people on the block, very few kids on the block. And since that time, it was a lot of people at the time were baby boomers' parents, and as they moved out to other areas, or you know, died or moved to assisted living, etc., then it's really changed around to now most of our neighborhood is young families with kids, and there's a lot of them from our block especially that go to Lake Nokomis Lutheran now. We came here when my son was born. He was actually baptized before we joined in the chapel, and then we decided to join the church. So that baptism, my daughter was baptized, my father was a minister, and Allie was baptized here, and we had all these people come up for the baptism. I remember that. I thought that was really cool. And they still do that today. They invite all the kids to come up to share in the baptisms. I remember fondly, the friendliness of the people here becomes like a family. when Robbie and my mother both died within about a month of each other. And at the time we had, you know, there's so many people that came up and were so, you know, let you know how important you were to them. And the pastor, Drew, actually was with my mom in the hospital, and she said, it's like having my own pastor. So that was really nice. My other fond memory is joining choir. I had never actually been in a choir until I came here, and I was sitting in church one day and somebody said, I thought you had a nice voice. So I thought, well, what the heck, I'll join choir. And it's been so much fun. It's really fun to be part of that choir community. And I think that in general, that's true of this church and most any church, is if you get involved in something, it becomes like your family. And it's looking back on all the memories we've had here, watching the kids grow up. And I think what's I like about this church is it's not just all kids in their 20s or adults, older people. It's a real mixture, and the older people are involved with the younger people and the kids. They don't say, you know, get out of here because I can't stand being around kids. They really enjoy kids, and the kids really enjoy them.
I have been reading some of the minutes of the women's groups that actually it started in 1907. The first meeting was on November 26th, and it was at 4949 27th Avenue South. It was overlooking Lake Nokomis. Reverend Grimsby, who called this meeting, and he wanted to form a ladies' aid. He thought that would be a very helpful group who could help him with the Sunday school that they had at that address every Sunday. The ladies' aid group was formed, and it would be in the name of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. An offering was taken. The offering amounted to $1.40. Now that seemed like a very small beginning, but you have to remember that at 1907, $1.40 was a lot more than it is today. Their purpose was always to be helpful to the church, to serve missions.
The Foreign Mission Department is happy to state that under God's guidance, our guild was able to fully support our missionary in Formosa. $3,915 was given, a goal we hoped to attain. Of this, $1,585 and a penny was gathered by the congregation through contributions in the Lenten dime folders. The balance was given by the Guild. Written by the Women's Guild in 1955.
The women had a very servant attitude. They started the bazaars very early on. They sent $50 to Mrs. Solvig, who was a missionary, and it was to buy a bicycle for her to use in China missions. And so they always had their ear out in knowing or asking and finding out what there was a need for. Women's roles, of course, changed so much because women were home. They were homemakers, and there weren't too many of them that worked. Naomi Circle in 1956 said they would start using their first names to be more friendly. And there is a list showing all of the past presidents of the women's group. And actually, it took until 1963 until Betty Bakken finally got to have her first name listed. Sometimes we were all thought of as women who are pretty staid and somber, but it wasn't all that way. Now, I was a member of the Rachel Circle, and we were meeting at Vivian Duncan's house. And we had had our lunch, and we were all sitting, in a circle, ready to begin our Bible study. We had our open Bibles in front of us. And she answered the front doorbell, and there was a young meter reader there. And he came in, and he looked very startled, seeing all these women with their Bibles, and it was kind of intimidating. And he hurried on through the room and got to the basement door and is going to just go down the steps. And Vivian said in a very loud voice, "I saw him first, girls." And we all busted out laughing, of course. And this poor young man, he just fled down the basement and came up as fast as he could again and just got out of the house. And we had kind of a long time before we could get settled down to our Bible study. There were, I'm sure in all churches, there were so many church dinners and so forth that the women would be involved in. And there were many mother-daughter banquets. Women were getting older who were in these circles, and it was in 2004, actually, that the women's group, as a formal women's group, was disbanded because we couldn't get enough people to sign up to be active. New women's groups have been formed. They take a different format than we have. They are still being very active in our church, but in a little bit different way. Oh my goodness, this church has produced some very staunch women. Oh, very, very strong women, yes.
Dorothy Deeby was a memorable person in this congregation. I think she taught the younger children in the congregation for, I don't know, 30, 40, 50 years. And she had a program every year where she had bells. And she brought all of the kids up at, I think it was a Christmas program. And Dorothy was a beloved person in the congregation.
When people were telling me about kind of those people that everyone remembers, Dorothy Deeby was one of those people. To have someone like her, so dear to so many people in this congregation over such a long period of time, the reason, I think, not only was that she was a wonderful teacher, but that she really loves kids. And it was evident as she would take attendance, at least the story that I hear, in her classroom. And then if Johnny didn't make it to Sunday school that day, she got a packet of the lesson for the day and maybe even a note. And put it in the mail? No, that wouldn't have been Dorothy Deeby. What Dorothy Deeby did was go to Johnny's house, knock on the door, and say, "Is Johnny doing okay? We really missed him today in Sunday school." That's Dorothy Deeby.
Miss Deeby's classroom was so great because it was just kind of like tradition to go to her class. Like everybody here from like my age to like 30 or 40 like years old, the members had all been taught by Miss Deeby.
To have that time with her, I think it developed a relationship as I grew up in the church, to the point where she would take me out for my birthday. And she found out, just like everyone found out she had a Bell collection, she found out that I collected dolls. And from that point on, she would give me dolls that she found at different sales that she'd go to or things like that. And so I have those memories to take with me as well. And she would always write me a birthday card, and she'd always sign it, Sister in Christ, Dorothy Deeby.
She seemed like she never aged. She always seemed like she was just perfect, and she always had her songs that would just teach us about God. It was great.
We never realized in 1907 that this was to be the beginning of a large and flourishing congregation whose activities would touch the lives of thousands. Sunday mornings, we would take the nearest streetcar line, Minnehaha Avenue to Minnehaha Falls, and from there walked over wide spaces with a lonesome house here and there to the banks of what was then known as Lake Amelia. Written by Omar Brenny.
25 years after this congregation began, Omar Brenny was called as its pastor. This was actually the Great Depression in the United States. So 1930 to 1939 were the years that he served here. I can't imagine a more difficult time in the life of the church. One of the people who was writing about that time said,
"It looked dark. Many had made pledges to the building fund, which had to be canceled. The fear that gripped the industrial world was also evident in congregational life. The pastor volunteered to take a cut in salary, and likewise, all salaries and expenses were reduced. But by united effort, there was no retrenchment in work. With God's blessing, the work progressed beyond all expectations, and our congregation now numbers 945 souls."
Somehow, though, the leadership of Omar Brenny, Pastor Brenny, allowed this congregation to look forward and not just get depressed about the Depression. One of the amazing things that we can see historically is that that congregation grew by 225 members during that really difficult financial time from 1930 to 1939 under Pastor Brenny's leadership. He was able to talk with the congregation evidently about these times are tough, and yet we still have a God who is with us in both good times and bad. And maybe, and in fact, that's one of the attributes in churches. Sometimes when times are most difficult is when we're most aware of God's presence in our lives and God's contribution and what God can do for us. And so people are willing to make some sacrifices. For whatever reason, this particular pastor was the right pastor for this time. There may have been other pastors with other kinds of skills that could have been called to help lead this congregation, and yet he was the one chosen, and seemed to be the right person for that particular time in the life of this congregation. If Pastor Brenny hadn't been the kind of leader that he was, we may very well not be celebrating 100 years of God's presence in this community today.
Dearly beloved in Christ our Lord, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Pastor Nastandi served this congregation from 1945 to 1968. This was a time in the life of this congregation when membership was at its peak. It was almost across the board. Urban congregations in the 1960s had as many members as any other time. There were over 2,000 members, 2,300 members here. This particular sanctuary was built during the time that Pastor Nastandi was here. It wasn't just because it would be nice to build another sanctuary. In fact, prior to that, there were three worship services every Sunday, and it was packed. I've heard stories about Christmases where extra chairs were set up, and people got here early, in fact, to get a good seat.
In fact, when we changed the church's structure years later, we took the pulpit down and changed where the preacher would preach from, and there were people who wondered if we should have taken Nastandi's pulpit down.
Almost a quarter of the time that this has been a congregation, he was in leadership. 25% of the baptisms that were done in this congregation, 25% of the people who were confirmed in this congregation, 25% of the weddings and funerals and worship services, 25% of the sermons that were given in this congregation were given by one person.
Pastor Nastandi married us. He asked us if we would say the Lord's Prayer together every night before we went to bed.
Our Father.
We have faithfully done that every night. And the blessing that he gave us through that prayer was a very strong marriage.
How did I relate to the Nastandi image is an interesting question. There were two pastors that were here before me and after Nastandi. But Nastandi had a big image in the city. He was a small man with a great big voice. We heard about how he always used to sing the Lord's Prayer in the service. I don't think that I've ever felt that I had to fill his shoes, but there was never a day that I said to someone that I'm a pastor at Lake Nokomis Lutheran Church, and they would say, is that Nastandi's church?
The 1968 date was really a tragic date in the life of this congregation because he actually died of a massive heart attack on that day. And so he was serving until that very day.
I'll always remember Christmas Eve services where he read poetry and verse intermixed with Christmas carols. And that was very special.
He was such a good, strong Christian man.
Mm-hmm.
As a pastor, mm-hmm. he was very committed to his faith.
Pastor Tony preceded me and then served until from 1995 to 2002, which is about a year after that is when I began my ministry here.
It was an interesting thing for me to come here because I had just come from 16 years of working with the National Church. So I hadn't been serving a parish for 16 years.
I think his legacy, his accomplishment here, was one of doing two things. There were significant changes made in this congregation in terms of the way that we would see it today, so that the sanctuary was shortened, allowing a much larger narthex, a gathering place for people both in between services, before important times in people's lives at funerals and weddings. There are always people gathered in that area.
One of my major memories in this place is that we spent a whole lot of time near the end of my time here remodeling the church. We did a whole lot of changing of the physical arrangements of the church. The narthex was changed, the elevator was put in. This was done by a phenomenal man who did a lot of work as building committee chairman, John Burgley. I kiddingly told him we should call it the John Burgley Construction because he put so much time and energy into it.
The building now has been made accessible to people, both visitors, friends, members, and this is a much more inviting kind of place.
This congregation probably helped me make the transition from the National Church. I had always loved parish ministry, and I always felt like I was kind of in the wrong place by working in the National Church, because a lot of times people were more concerned about the organization there than they were about the congregation.
He would tell stories about the people here.
The church is people. It's not building. It's not organization. It's people. So these people, Lake Nokomis, helped love me through the last active years in a parish in my ministry. I was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, and I therefore had to, it was on Thanksgiving Eve that I had my surgery, and my beloved partner, Carl Westby, took over. After I came back, after being gone from the pulpit for a month, and I walked into the congregation on the day that I came back from my medical leave, and I came to the lectern to give announcements, and the whole congregation stood and clapped to welcome me back. That was a touching moment for me. There is no way that I can ever think that Lake Nokomis didn't have a phenomenal impact on me at the end of my ministry.
I, Robert Lincoln Wold, take thee, Cheryl Janine Hammond. I, Cheryl Janine Hammond, take thee, Robert Lincoln Wold.
We got married January 7th, 1967. The night before our bridal dinner was the night before, and we had a blizzard. And he forgot his tux at the where we had the bridal dinner, which was the old Boulevard Cafe, and thank heaven somebody remembered to pick it up because they closed and we couldn't get at it.
It was around...
We got married at 7 o'clock at night, and there was about 100 people.
A long time ago.
It was a very simple wedding. Bob was in the service.
I was home on leave.
We didn't have a lot of money, and we really kind of put it together very quickly because when he found out when he could get leave, that January 7th was the only time that he could be guaranteed that he would be off, because if you'd done it at Christmas or something, they said, no, we can't guarantee it. So that's why we did it in January, and again, very simple, very inexpensive. The church took care of the cake and the food and everything, and then everybody went home.
May join your right hands. For as much as Robert Lincoln Wold and Cheryl Janine Hammond have now consented together in holy wedlock, I, as a servant of Jesus Christ, before God and these witnesses, do confirm your marriage covenant, pronouncing you husband and wife.
How long have you been married?
46 years in February, or no. January. Maybe we should start over.
One of the things you notice here is that the people are laid back. It's, you know, things are pretty much 9 to 5, and if you don't get your grocery by 6 o'clock, you know, you're out of the grocery for the next, you know, for that day until the following day.
Chemisier came here, I don't know, a couple months ago, I think, for the Zion Lutheran Church, and got to know him personally. I don't go to his church, I go to the Assemblies of God here in Cullum, but this community has actually already changed because of him. He's done a lot for our people, you know, just, it doesn't make any difference if you go to his church or not, you know, he's there for everybody, and it's kind of a cool thing. It's things that have really changed as far as people helping people. He's done just, his countenance is very, very rare.
One of the things that strikes you about Cullum is the hospitality of the people. In fact, I would say that when we first came for our interview here, that was the thing that hit us the most. So much so that on our way, going back to Minneapolis, and Susan and Heather, actually Heather said, well, Papa, you know, I just want you to know, if they give you a job, take it.
They're so welcoming. I mean, everybody seems to be so happy to have us. I mean, it's like you meet people in town like, and you feel like you've known them forever.
When I stand up at the pulpit to lead worship, I feel like they've been waiting for me to get here. One of the least spoken about is disappointment with God. Just say it. I feel so welcomed. They let me know in words and in deeds that this is where I belong.
Chemisi learning the community, and he takes a part of that and puts it, it's amazing how he puts it in his sermon. I mean, it's part of, so the people understand what he's saying. It's not like he's coming from the cities and sharing, this is what happened, you know, in the cities, this is how we do things there. It's like he's learning the people, he's learning the culture.
The Lord's table is open to all, and no one The things that I learned from Lake Nokomis that I've been able to bring here, that I bring with me to Zion Lutheran Church, you know, my experience being a member of the council, you know, albeit, you know, for about a year, because then I had to leave for internship. My experience as part of a worship planning team for one of the Easters, I believe. The experience helping out with confirmation, you know, I bring all those things here.
At Lake Nokomis, it was fun because when we were doing gathering for Sunday school, some of the, like, Tim Teamers or youths would lead it, and that would, like, encourage us to, like, want to lead it too. And here I would like to be in the choir, and maybe there'll be more younger kids like me that would want to do it too. It's just really fun to, like, be able to learn the songs and drum rhythms and be able to perform it in front of the church. I like am going on a journey because it just, it's easy to sing and easy to learn, and I just love the rhythm. I also like the piano part because it's, like, jazzy and cool.
Well, what?
I'm going on a journey, and I'm starting today. My head is wet, and I'm on my way. Christ's mark is on me, it's on you too. It says he loves me, and he loves you too.
That's great. Good job.
Thank you. Yeah. Good job.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
What drove me to be a pastor? Well, definitely God, for sure. That question always reminds me of something a pastor said to me one day when he asked me about the same kind of question, and I was, you know, giving him a brief clip of the story of my life. He said, yeah, you know, it's not the hounds of hell that you worry about. It's the hounds of heaven that you have to worry about, because they'll never leave you alone.
The Spirit is certainly blowing through this place this day. I invite you to lay your hands upon Him through those who are with us.
Ordained.
And I, this stole, as a sign of your word,
I remember putting the stall on him, and it just felt great.
Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens. Take heed to yourselves and to all the flock.
I was very proud and excited.
One of the first things that went through my mind was, like, finally, you know, finally. And especially because we met in the hospital, and I watched him minister to people, and I was one of those people. And I kept telling him that this is where he had to be. And I was just, it was just such, it's like, yes, God has finally, you know, brought him around to where he needed to be. And it was just, it was a very proud moment, but it was just very humbling too, to know that we're finally taking the steps where God wants us. And to know that he will now speak to others.
I will would definitely miss, like, everyone saying hello and just, like, wanting to start a conversation with me, because it was so nice that everyone in that congregation liked to talk to me, even though I was, like, a youth.
God has led me through so many things. Working in the hospital settings at the University of Minnesota and then Fayetteville, that was my training ground. I came to the U of M to study one thing, and I left with something completely different. It was there that God filled my heart with compassion and love for others, for people. And the love of God built up in me that was passed on to me through my parents and through so many people in the communities of faith that I've been part of. God used that to draw me into pastoral work.
Thank you for being there for me, for your prayers, your support. Even those that I think quietly may not have said a lot, we're still there. And I just would say thank you to Lake Nokomis Lutheran for helping me grow.
To say to people, you're welcome here. It doesn't matter where you come from. We enjoy having you as part of our community. Come and visit or remain. But we're part of this neighborhood.
My great granddaughter.
Growing up, I attended the Lake Wabagasset Bible Camp with several of my friends, and we would go during the summer. I also returned as I got older as a TIM team member, where that stands for Teens in Mission.
It wasn't until this past year that I got to go as a TIM teamer, and that's when we would go, and we stay actually away from the camp where the other campers are. And we have our own thing going on. We get there earlier, like 2 days earlier. We prep and just see how we're going to help our counselors with the kids. And then in the morning, we would go over to the camp where the campers are and then just experience church camp with them. And then at the end of the night, we go back to our camp.
Going to camp was always a fun experience. And having campfire at night, and my fondest memory is probably when we'd go in the chapel and sing camp songs. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, saved a wretch like me. Once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Alleluia, Alleluia. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. The mission trips that I have been on have been a life experience that I will never forget, and I'm so grateful to our church for helping to sponsor us and give us that opportunity to have that kind of faith journey. Our first mission trip was chaperoned by Jonathan and Teresa, and as our silly selves decided to tape Jonathan to the front seat while he was sleeping. And as a chaperone, it was even funnier. And the fact that he never woke up the entire time until we actually woke him up and he realized his predicament. And I think now as a chaperone that I hope nobody ever tries to pull that on me.
Something that I always remember about being at camp was the games. There's a game that we play called Mighty Mighty Scoop Noodle Challenge, where it's like you're on a giant, like four soccer fields field, like this huge field, and they make a perimeter out of these milk carton boxes, and then the whole camp plays at once. And there's like all these random items, like a football and a noodle on the other side, and there's two teams, and you run and try to take their team's item, and they tag you, and you're out, and it lasts for a long time. No one ever really wins. It's just a really fun game.
As a chaperone, it's always funny to look at the youth and think, oh, I totally have been there. And on one of the trips in particular, I remember kind of catching a couple of them and saying, like I didn't, you know, like I've never been there before. Or did you really think you're going to get by with that? And so to catch them in those things that, of course, I probably did. When I was on mission trips. For our first annual get-together for our young adult group, we planned a commando lock-in night.
Commando. Oh, I think every person should play in their lifetime. I first learned about it when my sister Veronica told me about it because she went to game night. And Commando is a game where two people are like the chasers and they each have a flashlight and they take an item and they hide it anywhere they want within a boundary that you make.
Sanctuary is off limits, but it has to be visible from at least 2 to 3 angles, and all the lights are off.
When you're running around the dark in Commando, there's always going to be like someone's going to get hurt, but it's like play at your own risk. I mean, if you get hurt, it's not like you can get babied, and like it's not like you get to like not be out. Like you still got to play by the rules, no exceptions.
And once they catch you with the flashlight, then you have to go to jail.
Everybody's in jail.
But hey, you know, you're a Christian and I'm a Christian, so it's gonna be a nice jail. I'm out. I'm sorry. Is that
you?
And it's a progressive jail where as more people come in, you get bumped out to go search again.
It sounds absurd. We don't get what we deserve. It's by grace. They say it sounds insane, we say that we've been changed.
The message of the game Commando is the Romans are trying to capture Jesus and his followers, and like the item, I'm pretty sure it's supposed to represent Jesus, and the Romans hit him like he's in the cell, and we're all trying to like rescue Jesus and bring him back, and like, so he can die for our sins and save us.
During our adult lock-in, it was probably the funniest game that we've ever played, because I think we know each other too well, to the point where we were strategizing on where the guards hid the box. And when we know each other, or we have twins, the Anderson twins, who were asking if they could channel the other one and see where they're hiding the box. But the last person to hide it was Shelby Svendahl, and her fiance at the time went and hid the item. And as we all met, we talked about where would Shelby hide this. And immediately, the answer was, she's going to hide it in the choir room. And sure enough, when it was time for us to take off, we all headed to the choir room, and we were back, and we have now dubbed that the fastest game of Commando ever.
Oh!
Oh, yeah, Commando!
Hey!
Hey! Commando!
When people ask, how do we get the 20 or 30 year olds here, I always say, I don't know, because I'm the one who's here. But I can't imagine being in another place. Lake Nokomis Lutheran Church has been my home. It's been my community. I consider the members here to be my family. And whenever I've needed anything, they're the ones that are here for me. And I will always value that in my life. And if I'm blessed to have a family and kids, I know that this would be the place that I would want to raise them and have that environment for them as well.
We all have like a path and like something we're supposed to do with God. Like you could call it destiny or like whatever you believe in, but like church kind of like set me on it. Like before, I was just kind of like going through life, just like going to school, hanging with friends, and like didn't really know what I want. And church has shown me a lot of like my values, I would say, and attributes that I could use in my life, and kind of just like started like the setting stones for my wall I'm gonna build to support me